Hello everyone, welcome to another video. Today we'll be exploring the question of why gravity works, which pertains to Seeliger's paradox. So why does gravity work? This was a question German astronomer Hugo Seeliger pondered in 1895, a time when the classical static and infinite model of the universe was the leading candidate for the origins of the cosmos. The universe was thought to be infinite and homogeneous, in other words meaning matter and energy was evenly distributed no matter where you looked in the vast stretches of space. As for Seeliger's problem, with Newton's law of gravitation, this arises from the following scenario. Taking into account that at this time period, the universe was thought to be infinite in size and uniform in matter distribution. Imagine we live in such a universe where these inaccurate parameters are correct, and we take a random test particle that we call particle A with mass m of A. We're going to try and calculate the gravitational force exerted on this particle by the infinite and uniform universe. For simplicity, we're going to consider all the mass in the universe to surround the test particle in concentric circles, similar to how a bullseye on an archery board is surrounded by concentric circles to form a target. However, as a consequence of the universe being infinite and uniform, we'd expect the external gravitational force of the universe on this test particle to be zero, since in any direction from particle A, you'd find an equally infinite amount of mass exerting an equal amount of gravitational force, in essence, canceling out all gravitational forces to zero. This is obviously problematic, since this would in essence render gravity useless and non-existent, which we know isn't true. Without gravity, stars and planets would never be able to form over time, as there would be no clumping of matter, causing the cosmos to be completely dark, cold, and seemingly empty no matter where you looked. Okay, so let's try this again. But this time, we're going to center our concentric circles of the universe around another test particle, particle B, which is an arbitrary distance r away from particle A. If we now break this model up into two parts, one which includes only the matter within the radius of particle A to particle B, and the second part being everything else in the universe outside of this radius, we are able to conclude the following. Considering we already determined the outside gravitational force of an infinite and uniform universe will equal a net zero gravitational force, we can exclude the second part, leaving us only with the matter within the radius of particle B to particle A. From this tells us that the gravitational force exerted on particle A is proportional to the distance of r from particle B to particle A, meaning depending on what particle B we choose, we get different answers for what gravitational force is exerted on particle A with mass m of A, which cannot be right. This left Seeliger with two options. One, either the universe cannot be infinite, such that the gravitational force of the universe on any set point is not a net zero, or two, Newton's law of attraction needs modifications. Seeliger opted for modifying Newton's law of attraction, to which he added an absorption factor to the force of gravity to fix the issue of calculating different gravitational forces exerted on particle A, in which lambda is an arbitrary parameter adjusted to match with the observational data for the solar system at the time to support Seeliger's addition of an absorption factor. This absorption factor, however, would prove to be unnecessary and false due to several inaccurate assumptions made about the cosmos. The downfall of Seeliger's line of reasoning has to do with more than just the fallacy of the leading beliefs surrounding the cosmos at the time, in which we now know that the universe isn't ageless, infinite in size, nor uniform in matter distribution. Instead, we believe the universe started with a beginning called the Big Bang, giving both time and the size of the universe finiteness, as well as further studies and observations showing that cosmological mass distribution is not perfectly uniform, as previous scientists and astronomers idealized at the time. The idea of living in a universe of perfect symmetry and balance is a common trap many great minds fall into and idealize over time, due to the highly appealing nature of picturing a world of perfect equilibrium. It's the equivalent of being presented with two rooms, one that's messy and cluttered, while the other room is neat and organized, and then being told to pick which room you'd like to clean. Overcoming a widespread set of beliefs deeply rooted as the undeniable truth in society also makes new scientific beliefs hard to come by successfully and efficiently. For reference, the belief that the Earth sat at the center of the universe persisted for roughly 1400 years. When it comes to Seeliger though, this unnecessary addition of an absorption factor also stems from the false assumption that the gravitational effect of the universe is an instantaneous effect, which is not the case. And by taking into account that there is in fact a delay of any given mass dispersing its gravitational force throughout the cosmos, we're left once again with the ability to calculate the intensity of said gravitational forces and fields using Newton's unaltered universal gravitation law. These results would prove to be accurate without any sort of absorption factor modification. And knowing that it takes time for the force of gravity to travel through space, Newton's original law of attraction can be further backed up by the notion that the cosmos is expanding at an accelerating rate, creating greater and greater amounts of empty, massless space, in which these gravitational fields would have to travel through over longer periods of time. Not only that, but in traveling greater distances for longer periods of time, the force of gravity weakens since it also follows an iteration of the inverse square law, which if you're not familiar with, we covered in a previous video pertaining to Olbers' paradox. Just like light, if you double the distance an object is away from you, that object will have 1/4 of the gravitational force it had on you than it did originally. Modern science and technology would also allow for the development of relativistic physics and Hubble's discovery of redshift, proving the universe is dynamic and accelerating in its expansion rate, putting an end to any sort of doubt that Seeliger's addition of an absorption factor is wrong. One final point to note about Seeliger's paradox are the mathematical inconsistencies with this line of reasoning. For as much as Seeliger's paradox can be disproved by physical observations made today with modern technology, Seeliger's paradox can also be disproved mathematically. For this situation, we're going to look at a similar model to which we saw previously, except particle A of mass m of A is going to be mapped a vertical distance h away from an infinite plane representative of the infinite plane of the universe that we assumed throughout this video. The infinite plane will have a mass per density per unit area of rho. In doing so, the concentric circles we saw earlier will be mapped out onto this infinite plane as annular rings that increase incrementally by an incremental width d of r, with an additional incremental force of d of f. The annular rings will also have a radius r away from the closest point on the plane to particle A, which we have simplified to the center of the universe for the sake of simplicity. There will also be the involvement of Newton's gravitational constant g, since we are testing the validity of Newton's law of gravitation and whether it needs modification or not. From this, and utilizing the following visual depictions, we can derive the following equation for the incremental force each extension of the universe has on particle A. However, this can be simplified with the following method. But, since we want to determine the total gravitational force of every mass in the universe on this specific infinite plane, we will integrate this incremental force spatially from 0 to infinity, which after utilizing some substitution and assuming 1 divided by infinity is approximately 0, derives the following solution. This answer, in which the total force of an infinite cosmic plane is equal to 2 pi times the gravitational constant times the mass of particle A times the infinite plane's mass per density per unit area, is only one infinite plane. And considering that this infinite plane is two-dimensional and is supposed to represent the mass distribution of the entire cosmos, we will need an infinite number of these infinite planes stacked one on top of the other in order to create a three-dimensional representation of the mass distribution of our three-dimensional universe. This will call for the use of a summation from negative infinity to infinity, to which the thickness of all of these infinitely stacked infinite planes, also called slabs, is equal to A. This thickness variable A is necessary in order to account for there being an infinite number of slabs. This equation, however, is what Seeliger came to the conclusion of, and in utilizing this equation, as we will see, different results can be found depending on how things are calculated, which is bad for validating Seeliger's method as a legitimate way to come to the conclusion that an absorption factor is necessary. Considering this equation, we can come to the conclusion that the total gravitational force of the universe is equal to zero, since in adding an infinite number of negative slabs to that of an equally infinite number of positive slabs, we find that they will all cancel out, such as in the example below shows. Considering that this follows Newton's law, and yet still returns the total gravitational force of the universe equals zero, Seeliger opted to add an absorption factor. But this, as we all know, is incorrect. So where is the mathematical inconsistency? For this, we are going to briefly review some terms about series. A series converges if there exists a finite value L, such that the sequence of the partial sums converges to L. In other words, convergence series, by definition, approach a specific number. Divergence series, on the other hand, have no limits, meaning it can only approach infinity or negative infinity. Now, if we wanted to obtain a more accurate result to the actual model of the universe, we would use these series for debunking Seeliger's paradox mathematically. However, since we've been making the assumption for simplicity that the universe is of a homogeneous mass distribution, we can use integrals instead, which will make our lives a little easier. This information on series and convergence will be important for later though. In this uniform mass distribution, we will utilize the cosmic volume density rho, as well as the spherical coordinate system, which is centered on particle A of mass m of A. Now, according to Newton's law, the total force exerted on particle A with mass m of A along the x-axis is the following. As can be seen, we come back to the same incorrect conclusion that the total gravitational force of the universe on particle A is equal to zero. But now we know that this result is due to the original integral being conditionally convergent. And we know a series is conditionally convergent if the original series converges on a finite number, but taking the absolute value of the series causes it to diverge to either infinity or negative infinity. We're not done yet though. Our last method in hopes of confirming Newton's law of gravitation is by interpreting space as a bunch of concentric shells consisting of spheres, since the universe is spatially three-dimensional. In doing so, we still center around particle A for simplicity, which is the distance r away from particle B. In reordering the conventions of the integral we already determined to be conditionally convergent, we get this for an equation. Since we know the integral is conditionally convergent, the order of the three integrals matters significantly. Therefore, the fact that we obtained a different result in this manner is not surprising. But the problem with this though is that in yielding a second solution from the same mathematical equation, this can in theory be done in an infinite number of ways, yielding many varying results. In such a predicament, there is no way to determine which result is the correct answer to how the universe behaves, therefore invalidating Seeliger's method of calculating that Newton's law of gravitation needs an absorption factor. There can only be one right answer, and since Seeliger used a mathematical method that can be manipulated to derive numerous answers, the basis for Seeliger's paradox cannot stand as justifiable. In conclusion, Seeliger's paradox is simply a mathematical manipulation of infinite conditionally convergent integrals to which no definitive answer can be found. Ultimately from this, Seeliger's paradox holds no physical significance to the infiniteness of the universe, meaning Newton's law of gravitation stands the test of time once more. Thank you all for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider liking and hitting that subscribe button with the notification bell on. To learn more about Seeliger's paradox, see the links to the research I used for this video in the description. If there are other ideas you'd like to see covered in a future video, please leave it in the comments below. Have a great day, everyone, and remember to stay curious.